Hi, this is Billy Vera. You're watching Ken Boxer Live on TVSB Santa Barbara.
Terry Ryken Realtor proudly presents Ken Boxer Live. From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live, Santa Barbara's one and only entertainment talk show. Let's welcome the host of the show, Ken Boxer.
Welcome, everybody.
This is wonderful. Thank you.
Santa Barbara.
Wow.
Lots of new faces.
Wow. Welcome to all of you. I'm Ken Boxer. This is Ken Boxer Live. Let me introduce you to my very talented co-host, Cate Imperio, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. What's the latest? I see a lot of people moving into Santa Barbara.
Yes, it's school starting. It's fall. We've got UCSB, one of the top party schools in the country, and SBCC,
great.
And your daughter's going to school?
Yes, she just started kindergarten.
Aww.
And I remember walking her to school. It's only like 3 or 4 weeks ago now, and just, you know, my heart was, you know, just pumping really hard. I can't believe she's already starting school.
Already starting school.
Yeah, so I'm very excited about that and looking forward to all the things that she's going to be studying and my helping her. But tell us, who do we have on the show tonight? Let's go to that.
Who do we have on the show tonight? Well, we have Grammy winner, singer, songwriter, actor, music historian, and author, Billy Vera, and he's gonna be performing his number one hit on our show tonight. So you're gonna wanna be here and check it out.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Palazzo Italian Restaurant, where people don't leave there hungry or thirsty. Gustafson Dance, meeting the highest standards in dance training. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. And now, back to our show.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Wow, thank you. Joining us tonight is one of the hardest working entertainers in show business. Our guest tonight is a Grammy and Peabody Award winner, and he also happens to have a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And of course, who could ever forget that song, that number one song at this moment, making his first appearance on our show. Let's welcome the extremely talented Billy Vera, everybody. So good to have you. Wow, look at this audience.
It's like a party.
It is.
I mean, it's like you know everybody in the audience. It's amazing.
You were invited.
And I was invited to your party. Do you all come every week, the same people?
How many come
every week?
They all come.
Wow.
We have
some cool.
Big dedication.
We love having you. Yeah, you're no stranger to Santa Barbara.
No, I was here last week. I took a dear old friend of mine out for his birthday, for his 100th birthday.
Wow.
A man named Art Roop, who owned a record company called Specialty Records, and those of you that are my age would remember that Specialty was the company that had Little Richard, Sam Cooke, Lloyd Price, and the great songwriter of the blues, Percy Mayfield, among many other artists.
Yeah.
And Art still goes to the office 5 days a week at 100 years old,
wow,
and he's
amazing.
Sharper than all of us put together.
Great.
Wow.
But, did you ever play Santa Barbara? Perform?
I did. I did. Lisa Gibbons' husband called me up secretly. What's the name of that beautiful hotel up the hill from
here? El Encanto.
El Encanto. And he said, I want you to come up quietly and surprise Lisa and sing your song at this moment. They're having a birthday party for 20 of her closest friends. And so she was very happy.
Yeah, I would imagine so.
Yeah.
Wow, that's
it was cool.
Captive audience.
It was fun, yeah.
Wonderful. But When did you realize that music was going to be your area? I mean, back in high school, were you
involved? The first time I was about 11, I heard Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. Anybody remember Frankie Lyman? Why Do Fools Fall in Love?
That song I know.
Yeah. Well, you know, Frankie was a year older than me, and I heard him on the radio, and I said, my God. You know, with Frankie, and I used to play guitar for Ronnie Spector from the Ronettes, and Ronnie told me, and she got her style from Frankie, and she said, you know, Billy, when the first time I heard Frankie Lyman, I didn't know if he was a boy or a girl or if he was black or if he was white. And it struck me when she said that, that was the answer to why rock and roll became so popular. We didn't know or care who the people were or what they were. We just loved that music. You know, that's what made rock and roll what it became.
Yeah,
now, well, before we went on the air, you were telling us some stories about how you in New York, you know, singing on the corners of the streets.
Yeah, well, doo-wop was the thing when I came up, and you'd stand on the corner under the street lamp at night, and the guys would sing, okay, you take that note, man, you take this note, and I'll take that note. And I'd go, okay, ready? Boom, boom, ba boom, ba boom, boom, ba boom, 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 and we'd be singing. Well, the reason we sang was we wanted to attract the girls, you see. and it was a neighborhood, it was like Italian and black. So I'd get nice, pretty Italian girls like Cate, and they'd come over and say, oh, we love when you sing that song. And so that's how we met girls, you know.
We were successful?
Well, you know, if you could sing better than the other group down the other corner, okay. You would be, that was the thing, very competitive, you right. know. There was a group, in Harlem, there was a lot of groups, and on every street corner, it seemed like, there was the Cadillacs who made Speedo, there was the Harp Tones, the Clef Tones, the whatever tones, you know. And there was the group, the Harp Tones was the one, the beat. They would sing at St. Nicholas Park. And they had a singer in that group named Willie Winfield, who had the most beautiful voice you ever heard in your life. And even the Cadillacs, who were a great group, they always said, man, when the Harp Tones came up to St. Nicholas Park, man, we all went to the other side of the park because we didn't have a shot. I will do Willie. One time I went to the Brooklyn Fox Theater to see a rock and roll show. The star of the show was not a rock and roller, it was Johnny Mathis, so he went on last. Johnny's a wonderful singer, a great singer.
Still performing today.
Still performing to this day, you know, beautiful voice. Well, he had to follow the Harp Tones. Willie comes out there and he sings, five notes. Will you take part in? The place went nuts. Just that much. And I said, man, Johnny Mathis is going to put his tuxedo back in his suitcase and go back to California because you ain't going to follow Willie Winfield.
I want to know, how did you make the jump, though, from street singer to all of a sudden you're in the studio, you're recording? I mean, there's got to be some.
Well, I learned.
Apollo Theater, that's right.
I wanted to learn how to play. I saw Chuck Berry on American Bandstand. You know, and I said, I want to be him. Not crazy like him, but I want to be like him. And so I went and I saved up my little lawn mowing and snow shoveling money. And I got $35 together. And I went over to Sears and I bought me a $35 guitar. Black and white, silver tone special. I wish I still had it. And I learned how to play guitar. And so there was a sophomore talent show at Archbishop Stepanak High School. And so we decided to join the talent show. And my best friend, John, was tone deaf. He couldn't hear to tune his guitar. So I had to tune his guitar for him. But his father bought him an amp, and we needed John. And then Henry had never picked up a set of drumsticks in his life, but I taught him two songs on the drums. And we stunk. But we played rock and roll. And then we had a couple of friends up in the spotlight booth that put pink and purple gels on us. And we went to the Army and Navy, so we bought white jackets. And we bought shirts that were like Kate's dress, you know, shiny, black, and little string ties like Chuck Berry wore on his album cover. And so we had flash. And we learned that flash trumps talent every time. And we won 296 out of 298 votes. And the priest that was the music teacher in our school hated us, never spoke another word to us the whole rest of our high school career. Father McCann, he didn't like us very much. The guy that should have won was a fellow by the name of Germano Romano, who was a wonderful classical piano player. His hands in sophomore year were insured for $100,000. And he was really talented, and we stunk, and he got two votes for Germano.
Tell us about the mega hit that you had that still today people are singing. In fact, we had Dave, one of our audience members, a friend of mine, said that he used it to actually win one of his singing shows that he
You know, a guy that owned a magazine called a Karaoke Magazine once told me, he said, your song is the number one karaoke song of all time. And I said, well, that means more people mangled my song than any other song. I will tell you a story. We have no miners in here, right?
So no. I can Define tell miners.
Huh?
Define
coal miners, yeah. Well, about 5 years ago, I get a call from this woman who is the number one porn star in the world named Julianna. Beautiful woman. And she said, Billy, she said, they're having the 8th anniversary of porn star karaoke at this restaurant, Sarno's. And so would you come and sing your song? She says, we're sick of everybody messing up your song at your karaoke all the time. I said, well, I'll do it if you introduce me. So here comes the beautiful Julianna, you know, and she is just, and now my dear friend, Billy Vera, and I'm singing to a track, you know, and all the little porn stars are out there going, ah! Porn star karaoke.
Like back in the day.
Yeah, baby.
But this song that you did at this moment really was the mega hit that put you on the map, wouldn't you? Would that be a fair statement?
It put me kind of back on the map, and it made me it put me in the club. We'll say that, because I'd had a couple of hits in the '60s. First, as part of a duo, the first interracial duo with a woman named Judy Clay, who was one of the Drinkard singers, out of which came Dionne Warwick, Dee Dee Warwick, Sissy Houston, Whitney's mother, mm-hmm. and all these wonderful, wonderful singers. Judy was so great. She was the lead singer. So we sang this song called Storybook Children, and it became a hit before anybody saw a picture of us. And so we got a booking at the world-famous Apollo Theater in Harlem, and which was the pinnacle of black show business. I mean, everybody from Billie Holiday to Ray Charles to Aretha Franklin had appeared on those sacred boards. So we get there for rehearsal. It was a 7-day-a-week house, as we call it, and 5 shows a day. And there were maybe 8 or so acts on the show. And of course, they put us on second, which is the worst spot, reserved for new acts or not so good acts. And the opening act is always a flashy with a lot of choreography. Hey, get excited, everybody, right? So we're on second. Honey Coles of the famous dance team Coles and Atkins was the theater manager. And he said, now listen, he says, what I want you to do, Harlem hasn't seen you yet, meaning me. He says, so what I want you to do, he said, Judy, you enter from stage right. And Billy, you enter from stage left. You let her take 1, 2, 3 steps, and then you make your entrance. And watch what happens. So I'm sitting there playing our chase music to bring her on. Dun, 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 dun. And I go, 1, 2, 3. And I hear 1,500 people at 10:30 in the morning gasp. And I hear people going, that's him? That's him? Well, you know, we could have... And meanwhile, across the river in Newark, New Jersey, there was riots going on. So it was a little rough, you know. Well, we went over so well, Honey Coles comes upstairs to our dressing room, And he says, you know, I'm going to change up the show. He said, I'm going to put you all on before the star. He says, because ain't nobody going to follow you two mother. And so that became our spot. You know, we were always before the star.
Right.
You know, and so that was the Apollo Theater. And that was a dream for me because I had been a customer at the Apollo Theater as a teenager. I would go up there and see all my my heroes, you know.
But we want to interrupt you just for a moment to get to
Don't ever interrupt
moment.
The star.
I'm going to interrupt the star. We want to hear this beautiful song that we all know and love. If you could bless
I'll sing
us with it.
I'll sing it.
Wonderful.
Sure.
Everybody. Will you sing it in this moment?
I'll
right
sing
now?
It. Yes, I will. What did you think I would do at this moment? When you're standing before me with tears in your eyes, trying to tell me that you found you another, and you just don't love me no more. Oh. What did you think I would say at this moment, when I'm faced with the knowledge that you just don't love me? Did you think I would curse you or say things to hurt you? 'Cause you just don't love me no more. Did you think I could hate you, raise my hands to you? Come on, you know me too well. And how could I hurt you, darling? I love you, and you know I'd never, never hurt you. Oh, oh, what do you think I would give at this moment? If you'd stay, I'd subtract 20 years from my life, and I'd fall down on my knees, kiss the ground that you walk on, if I could just hold you again. Wanna play a little saxophone solo? I'd fall down on my knees, and I'd kiss the ground that you walk on, baby, if I could just hold you, if I could just hold you, if I could just hold you again. Gotta be right on it, man.
I just realized, Billy, that our co-host Cate wasn't even born when that came out.
That is correct.
That is correct. She's just a mere child.
But yet, that song, just generation to generation, has just been picked up.
The thing about it was, I was told at the time it was popular, that people were buying it from like junior high school, their prom song, to people in their 60s and 70s. It crossed every boundary. It was popular on the pop charts, the country charts, the rhythm and blues charts, the adult charts. I mean, it was just one of those rare grassroots kind of songs.
No one could ever forget Family Ties.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Well, the song had been out in 1981. And the record company went, just when the record company we were with at the time went out of business. So it rose to about number 79, and the end, the song was dead. My career was dead. I couldn't get another record deal. 5 years later, one day I'm home, feeling sorry for myself, waiting for my agent to call to give me an acting gig. And a man says, "Is this the same Billy Vera that has the band?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, my name is Michael Whitehorn, and I produce a show called Family Ties. And we're preparing an episode that we were at the club the other night. We heard you sing the song, and we thought it might work for this episode." I said, "Cool." And I put him in touch with the publisher, and they got a license to use the song. And I got a bag of mail. And I'd had songs on television shows before and never got any mail, just $200 here and there, and it was nice. But I said, "Well, you know, maybe people really like this song. Maybe I should try to do something." So I called up the few contacts I still had in the business. By now, I'm 40 years old. And everybody turned me down. And so I'm having lunch with a fella named Richard Foos, who had a company called Rhino Records that they put out oldies, right? Nothing but oldies, and they weren't in the contemporary record business. So I said, "Hey, Richard, this is what happened, blah, blah, blah. How many records do you need to sell to break even?" He said, "Well, we have low overhead here." He said, "We could get by on a couple of thousand." I said, "I'll guarantee you a couple thousand records. I'll sell them in the clubs if I have to. I'll get Cate to sell them on her comedy gigs." And so he said, "Yeah." And he only did it because he liked me. You know, he didn't really think anything was going to happen with it. Well, the show comes on again. They use it the following season, and this time the girl breaks up with Michael J. Fox, Michael cries, America cries, and the record becomes the number one record in the country. And
yeah, I would also would love to have your new book become the number one book in the country.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yes, let's talk about it just briefly. We only have to two and a half minutes left on the show.
Wow.
The inspiration of the book.
People were bugging me for years saying, "When are you going to write your autobiography?" And I couldn't figure an angle. And I finally just said, "You know, I'm just going to tell the story." And I sat down in my computer and typed and wrote. And I'm blessed with a good memory, so got it right, I think.
Well, great. You can get this on Amazon.
Sure can. And or at your local bookstore, if you still like
if
that.
If you have one.
If you have one, yeah.
What would you actually like for people, when people read this book, From Harlem to Hollywood, what would you like the reader to actually leave with when they've read it?
Well, I think it should be interesting because it's not just about me, the whole about me. It tells the story of show business throughout my lifetime. So you'll meet a lot of characters, not always the most famous people, but wonderful, wonderful, talented people, some famous, some not, that you should know about. And maybe you'll go to Wikipedia, you'll look them up. Maybe you'll go to Amazon and buy their CD. Maybe you'll look for them on YouTube, and maybe you'll learn something about it. So I think it's a nice history of show business that I happen to be a part of.
But this isn't the first book you've written, correct?
No, I did a photograph book called Vintage Neon LA 1979, which was pictures that I took when I first came here. I remarked upon all the wonderful old neon signs that were there at the time. And so I had my bass player drive me around at night, and I said, "Stop the car here," click. And I took all these pictures, and I had slides in those days. You know, you didn't have your camera, your phone. And I put them away, and this girl was over at my house about a year ago, and she says, "These are awesome pictures. They're beautiful. You should do a book. You should do a gallery showing." So she's one of these real go-getters, you know, and So she got me a book.
Well, the new book, the new book, Billy Vera, Harlem to Hollywood, destined to be a number one seller.
Oh, you know what I'd like to plug too?
What's that? Go ahead and plug.
I'd like to plug my big band album. Anybody love big band music?
Yes. Yeah. About 10 seconds.
Billy Vera, Big Band Jazz, it's called, on Amazon.
All right, thank you so very much. Thank you. Well, that's it. So for our guests, Billy Vera and Cate Imperio, and our director, Nick Ferretti, and the entire KBL crew, I'm Ken Boxer. Good night, everybody, and thank you.
Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Terry Riken, your broker with a personal touch for all your real estate needs. Gustafson Dance, meeting the highest standards in dance training. Palazzo Italian Restaurant, people don't leave there hungry or thirsty. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Petrini's Family Restaurant, La Quinta Inn and Suites. Taffy's Pizza, delivery, pickup, or dine-in. Country Catering, Meat Market and Deli. Lido's Takeout. Jack's Bagels and Bistro, the Ken Boxer Live musical theme composed and arranged by Mr. Michael J. Leslie. At Ken Boxer Live, I'm Baron Ron Heron. Good night, everyone.